Good evening and welcome to the ceremony for the presentation of the 2016 Pritzker Architecture Prize. It is a privilege for me to speak at the opening words at this, the 38th ceremony in which we honor Alejandro Aravena. Tonight we have in the audience guests from all over the world, and I would like to make a special welcome to His Excellency Juan Gabriel Valdez, Ambassador of Chile, His Excellency Cristian Barros, Permanent Representative of Chile to the United Nations, the Honorable Penny Pritzker, Secretary of Commerce, and special people, of course, are the Pritzker family. In particular, Cindy Pritzker, founder with her late husband Jay of the prize, which today is also enthusiastically supported by her son and daughter-in-law, Tom and Margot Pritzker. Previous laureates with us tonight are Tom Main, Richard Meyer, Glenn Merkett, Jean Nouvel, Christian de Portzen Park, Renzo Piano, Richard Rogers, and Wang Xu. And we fondly remember all the laureates who are not here tonight with us. We welcome Alejandro Aravena's family and collaborators. And finally, a most heartfelt welcome to all our distinguished guests and good friends. Pritzker Prize ceremonies have been held all across the globe, including Buenos Aires, Washington, D.C., Rome, Moscow, Istanbul, and many other places, always in historic sites or contemporary ones. From the Jerusalem Archaeological Park, representing thousands of years of history, or the Todaji Temple, originally founded in the 8th century in Nara, Japan, to very contemporary sites such as the Getty Center in Los Angeles and the New World Center in Miami Beach. All are selected for their outstanding qualities of place. We are grateful to the United Nations for hosting this wonderful setting. Today, declared by the UN International Day for Mine Awareness and Assistance in Mine Action. And I hope you have had a chance to see the exhibition in the lobby of this important, about this important matter. I would also like to thank the UN and especially the Sustainable Development Goals Fund for their collaboration and generosity in making us feel so much at home in the United Nations headquarters for the 2016 Pritzker Prize events. Kevin Roach, laureate in 1982, who was speaking at a ceremony somewhat like this one about the enormous challenges facing architecture in the future, said, "To build well is an act of peace." What a fitting phrase to remember in this memorable setting of the United Nations. Now we are privileged to hear the words of welcome via video from UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon.
Distinguished members of the Pritzker family, members of the Pritzker Prize jury, this year's laureate, Senor Alejandro Aravena, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted that this year's Pritzker Architecture Prize ceremony takes place at United Nations headquarters, which is itself a masterpiece of planning and design. We are flattered that the World's Workshop of Peace joins a list of esteemed historic sites around the world that have hosted the Pritzker ceremony. The work of this year's Pritzker laureate, Alejandro Aravena of Chile, shows how much architecture can contribute to achieving our shared goals. The United Nations is striving to build resilient societies and to support the most vulnerable members of society. Senor Aravena is a pioneer in low-cost social housing and in rebuilding cities after natural disasters. The world needs an energy revolution to meet the threat posed by climate change. Senor Aravena's work is helping to reduce energy consumption. The United Nations aims to make cities safer and more inclusive. Senor Aravena's schools, parks, and public spaces are doing precisely that. I congratulate Senor Alejandro Aravena on this recognition. The United Nations looks forward to working with architects and related disciplines to build lives of peace and dignity for all on a healthy planet. Please accept my best wishes for a memorable ceremony. Thank you.
The Lord Palumbo, Chair of the Jury.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. At a dinner last night given by Cindy Pritzker for past laureates, together with the members of the jury and their wives, we stood for a minute's silence as a tribute to Zaha Hadid. The 2004 Pritzker Prize laureate, and therefore, by definition, a member of the extended Pritzker family. This brief eulogy gives me no time to speak about Zaha in any depth. Her singular brilliance as an architect, her role as a standard bearer for the equality of women, and her staunch and unremitting opposition to prejudice in its many forms, in all of which she received a level of worldwide recognition given to very few. I shall simply remember here and now, this complicated, contrary, and utterly wonderful lady of indomitable spirit, as she was to her friends, loyal, compassionate, gentle, kind, and always funny. Most of all, I shall miss her voice on the telephone only a few days ago, mimicking faultlessly the Cockney accent from the East End of London, where she lived. Our conversation went like this. "Hello, Peter," she said. "Hello, Zaha, love," I replied. "What's up?" "Nothing much," she said. "Ain't feeling too good today. Can't manage them apples and pears." Cockney slang for stairs. "But hope to see you and Hyatt in New York on the 4th of April." She never made it, of course. But here we all are for you, Zaha love, in death as in life. The arts exist to help us recover the sensation of life. This is the first time that I have chosen a title for a speech of this kind. 11 memorable words spanning as many years. Years that I liken to the magical, flickering images from the camera lens of a pioneer of modern photography, Edward Muybridge, providing a succession of seamless, indelible, utterly absorbing, and endlessly exhilarating memories of my time as chairman of the Pritzker Prize. Increasing still further, if such a thing is possible, my deep admiration for and gratitude to the Pritzker family, and most especially to Mrs. Cindy Pritzker, without whom there would be no prize. And by the same token, no cause to mark the celebration today of the 38th annual awards ceremony of the prize. And to honor the outstandingly talented architect from Santiago, Chile, Alejandro Aravena, but also to Tom and Margot Pritzker, who have been wise beyond measure at all times, as well as supremely supportive throughout. Indeed, I would argue that the global success of the prize, from its very inception in 1979 to the present, owes much to their unfailing generosity of mind and spirit. Add to that a jury of exceptional caliber and an administrative team that operates with all the assurance of a cool, calm, and collected professional mindset that is a joy to behold. And it is no wonder that the sum of all those parts produces rock-solid foundations that provide a perfect platform of support for the lifeblood upon which the prize depends, namely, a lifetime's achievement in the built environment, a consistently high level of excellence, and crucially, a contribution to humanity. Now, if these remarks have about them somehow or other a valedictory ring, that is indeed the intention, as we move forward to consider the intriguing and even inspiring account of two Russians. The first, a literary critic by the name of Viktor Shlikovsky, you have met already, albeit indirectly, and I hope admired, for it was from the flow of his pen that those 11 memorable words emerged as the title of this speech. The arts exist to help us recover the sensation of life. And then his compatriot, the Russian filmmaker Andrei Tarkovsky, ranked incidentally by Ingmar Bergman, no less, as the greatest maker of films in the world, posed a penetrating and thought-provoking question when he said, "Perhaps our capacity as artists to create is evidence that we ourselves were created in the image and likeness of God." Those two quotations strike a deep note for those like me who firmly believe that the artist is the most important member of society and should be cherished as such, for the good and simple reason that at their best, the arts represent the highest achievement of which the human spirit is capable. That said, it is only a hop, skip, and a jump to claim that artistic talent at an exalted level is indeed bestowed by some higher dimension. And therefore, the arts must be regarded as an integral part of life, and not merely an adjunct to the business of living, to be clipped on and snapped off like a bow tie as and when the occasion demands. And so we come to the perceived wisdom that there exist in life only two circumstances and only two certainties: death and taxation, neither of which is particularly palatable, so that they should have added to them a third certainty, namely the power of the arts to help change the face of humanity for the general good. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is no pipe dream, for the lessons of history have demonstrated over and over again, since time immemorial, that the arts have come to the rescue of peoples from all four corners of the globe, in good times and bad, invoking in the process that same higher dimension, offering an alternative future, boosting morale, and providing reassurance, hope, and optimism. And where better to begin than with the art of architecture, the first of the arts in terms of its prominence and reach as a shelter for man. At this 38th annual prize giving of the Pritzker Prize, held in the hallowed precinct of the United Nations headquarters building in New York City. Surely the most appropriate forum imaginable for such a high purpose. At this point, I want to change the narrative in order to analyze in a little detail the qualities that Aravena brings to bear as an architect by comparison with the criteria that I have already outlined: a lifetime's achievement in the built environment, a consistently high level of excellence, and crucially, a contribution to humanity. In a still developing and hauntingly beautiful country, at the very end of the Earth's southern reach, it is to those people in Chile who exist below the poverty level, to whom Aravena has dedicated most of his professional life, his hopes and his dreams, by helping them to recover the sensation of life. And this he has achieved through brilliance of mind, heart, and spirit. Disregarding obstacles in his path and making it possible to realize his dream. And this he has done by acting as designer, political activist, innovator, educator, and enabler, by fusing the physical, the physical, sociological, and economic requirements of the homeless and the dispossessed, with the paucity of funding and the lack of materials available to him, to create against all the odds, and as if by a miracle, a symphony of solutions, basic but beautiful, out of a clear blue sky. And in so doing, he has restored to them a garland of dignity and a ray of optimism and hope for the future when all seemed around them to be lost. There is no doubt that the unqualified success of Aravena and of his wonderful team, Elemental, has stemmed from his discovery that the lessons learned from the design of social housing on the one hand and the grand project on the other have informed and influenced one another to an extraordinary extent. Skills honed in the fierce and relentless focus upon the retention of essentials whilst discarding the superfluous and committing it to oblivion. And the miracle of social housing apart, this is best illustrated by Aravena's innovation building in Santiago, a wonderful structure by any standards that won the highly coveted Building of the Year award in 2015 against stiff opposition from some of the world's leading architects. In addition to his other qualities, Aravena possesses an unbounded energy that never sleeps. Much like the city of New York, in fact. But in his case, it is not at all apparent whether as a tireless visiting critic at Harvard University, whether as a charismatic teacher through the medium of lectures that he delivers the world over, whether as a designer at the coalface of social housing and the large-scale project, whether as the curator of this year's Venice Biennale, whether as the 2016 laureate of the Pritzker Prize. This great, concealed, boundless energy goes hand in hand with an innate humility and modesty the selflessness of one who gives credit due to him gladly and with a full heart to others. A man who dares to dream as visionaries do. Of an architecture that celebrates the human condition and the human spirit, sublimating the self in the service and for the benefit of humanity, pointing the way forward to better understanding, tolerance, mutual respect, reconciliation, civilized values, and peace on earth. The self-same principles, in fact, that guided the founding mission of the family of the United Nations. Which is why, when I have been invited to summarize in a few words the revelation of Aravena, I like to quote the last lines of a famous sonnet entitled, When First Looking into Chapman's Homer, by the 19th century poet John Keats. Then felt I like some watcher of the skies when a new planet swims into his ken, or like stout Cortes when with eagle eyes he stared at the Pacific, and all his men looked at each other with a wild surmise, silent upon a peak in Darien. This jury has the same collective feeling of surmise about the work of Aravena and his qualities as a man. We stand in awe and applaud with admiration his vision for the future. We too fall silent as we stare in wonder at the Pacific as it laps and caresses the entire coastline of Chile. And finally, we are reminded of a better, more just, more peaceful world of civilized values than the one that we inhabit today. The Pritzker Prize is the very least that can be offered to Alejandro Aravena by way of return. Thank you. And now, before I invite Tom Pritzker as chairman of the Hyatt Foundation to present to Alejandro Aravena the 2016 Pritzker Prize for Architecture, I would very much like to introduce to you the members of our jury, who I will ask to stand as I call out their names in alphabetical order. First, the distinguished Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States from Washington, D.C., Stephen Breyer.
What? You sit down. If you want.
Next, the distinguished art historian, writer, architectural curator, commentator, and educator from Berlin, the Federal Republic of Germany, Christian Freireis. Next, the distinguished architect and 2002 Pritzker Prize laureate from Sydney, New South Wales, Australia, Glenn Murcutt. Glenn. Glenn, keep standing, keep standing. At the end of this award ceremony, Glenn will succeed me as chairman of the Pritzker Prize. And he will do it proud. He is not only a brilliant architect with a beautiful mind, but he is also the most honorable and the truest of men, as well as being the most devoted and stalwart of friends. Please give Glenn Murcutt once again a particular welcome. Next, the distinguished architect and 2007 Pritzker Prize laureate from London, England, Richard Rogers. Next, the distinguished architect from Barcelona, Spain, Benedetta Tagliabue. Next, the distinguished architect and industrialist, and until recently chairman of the group that bears his name, from Mumbai, India, Ratan Tata. And last, but by no means least, the distinguished architect and educator from Beijing, the People's Republic of China, Yongho Chang. And now it only remains for me to say thank you, so long, and in deference to our laureate, adios.
Now it is my privilege to invite to the podium the president of the Hyatt Foundation, Mr. Tom Pritzker.
Thank you very much, Martha, Peter. Ladies and gentlemen, before I start my formal remarks, I want to pay homage to my friend, Lord Peter Palumbo. Peter, as he said, has been chairman of our jury for 11 years. Tonight, he's retiring as chairman. Navigating a prize of this character and a jury of such standing is not always an easy task. Like a duck gliding smoothly on top of the water, when needed, Peter was paddling like hell underneath the water. To say that Peter has served ably is an understatement. In contemporary vernacular, he's been awesome. Peter, you've made a difference in our understanding of the field of architecture. And so on behalf of the juries that you've led and on behalf of our family, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. In testimony to the fact that architecture is the art form of greatest consequence for humanity, the Pritzker Architectural Prize has been awarded in such sites as the Western Wall in the Old City of Jerusalem in Israel, in Rome in a plaza designed by Michelangelo on the Capitoline Hill, in the White House in Washington, D.C., and in the Great Hall of the People of Beijing. All are places whose ideas and policies came to shape the world and its vision of our individual and collective roles in the world today. However, never before has the prize been celebrated and awarded in the one building, the one contemporary institution that strives to represent all of the people in the world. The United Nations, born of the failed League of Nations and catastrophes of World War II, it's the place in which men and women from every corner of the planet come, hopefully to reason with each other on behalf of their fellow citizens and to the betterment of all. In today's world, the velocity of change is accelerating at an unprecedented rate. This increasing rate is true in all spheres and in most walks of life. This may in fact be the hallmark of our times and may also be one of the greatest challenges of our times. Therefore, it's fitting that tonight we honor the youngest laureate of the Pritzker Architectural Prize, Alejandro Aravena of Chile, who defines architecture as a collective discipline whose participants must walk together into an uncertain future. The laureate and the venue of the ceremony are chosen by two separate and distinct groups, the laureate by the jury and the venue by my family. At times, these two independent decisions have a powerful, almost magical relationship. Such is the case tonight as we come together to honor Alejandro in a place redolent of faith, courage, optimism, struggle, and ultimately perseverance, all qualities of tonight's laureate. Let me go back to the challenges that come with an accelerating rate of change that we're experiencing. It's altogether possible that the pace of disruptive technologies has benefited us as consumers, but has adversely impacted some of the principles that undergird our institutions, as well as our moral and political sensibilities. We're in an era that calls for agility of thought. These times demand that the organization of our social, political, and economic lives benefit from the multiple disciplines, from multiple disciplines and perspectives. Alejandro has come of age in this daunting and powerful new circumstance. He's a digital native who employs all of modern technological assets, yet in his person and his practice, he presents to us a model of humility. Where technology threatens to substitute the power of information for endurance of common sense and wisdom, he practices his art with the pronoun we. He's a collaborator. Where technology threatens to overwhelm the individual, he engages in social architecture that invites collaboration of the people who live in the houses that he designs and builds, to continue to build those houses so that they may become true homes. This is the respectful form of collaboration. Aravena provides vision, design, engineering, and construction. He then turns to those in the urban settings who will live in these homes. He tells them, build it out, add to my work, and make it yours. This shows a deep respect for the responsibility and the capability of the individual to understand what's in their own self-interest. Aravena has undertaken projects of different scales and from social housing to large institutional buildings. In all his work, he approaches the task with freshness and ability to start without a predetermined idea or form. For him, the beginning is a question, not an answer. His creative process engages residents, local authorities, lawyers, politicians, researchers, developers, and those in the business community in order to obtain the best results. In this way, Alejandro Aravena epitomizes the possibilities of socially engaged architecture, especially in his long-term commitment to tackling the global housing crisis and fighting for a better, more ecologically sound urban environment for all. Like the principles at the very foundation of the United Nations, his ultimate goal is social progress and better standards of life in larger freedom. The Charter of the United Nations calls for the people of the world to practice tolerance and live together in peace with one another as good neighbors. What greater ambition could there be? This too is the role of the architect, who is now challenged to serve greater social and humanitarian needs. Alejandro Aravena has clearly and generously and fully responded to this challenge. The occupational hazard of all great artists is, of course, self-importance. Indeed, it takes a powerful ambition and incredible passion to create great art. Yet above all, Alejandro Aravena is a man of humility. He sees the realities of everyday life in all of its messy and rich contradictions as the beginning of his art, not as an obstacle to it. He received news of the award of the Pritzker Architectural Prize in the most prosaic yet poetic of all settings, at home. Among his family, he was playing with his daughters when the call came in. Somehow, this too doesn't feel like a coincidence, as his architecture is a life lived among others and the principles of love and commitment that only family can teach. So let me introduce our 2016 laureate by reading a letter that I received from him 2 weeks after he learned that he had won the Pritzker Prize. Dear Tom, it's been a couple of weeks now since I received the news, the completely unexpected news. I was speechless then, and I continue to be speechless now. Had I anticipated it, my reaction may have been different, but I didn't see it coming. It was Saturday morning. The girls were playing next to me. My wife was sleeping upstairs. And I get this message from Martha asking about some things related to the Biennale. I thought, oh my God, what now? I better take care of this right away before it grows. I was expecting another problem to solve because I was in the middle of a bunch of battles on the Biennale front. So then, all of a sudden, the news. The moment was just pure emotion. I began to cry. I couldn't think. I still can't. I vaguely remember that we talked for about 20 minutes, but I don't really recall what we talked about. I went upstairs, woke up my wife, and told her the news. Her reaction was like mine. We didn't know what to say. Then the girls came and asked, why was I crying? The only thing I was able to say was, I was very, very happy. I guess it was all the years of physical effort, trying to do my best in the projects, and all of my difficulties we had to overcome to get things done. Revisiting, being patient, absorbing kicks from tough counterparts, and then finally getting self-explanatory feedback that our intuitions were in fact correct. The most powerful thing about the prize is that we see a lot of freedom ahead. This is because we already arrived. I mean, there are many things one is supposed to do in order to develop a career. First you do this, then you do that, and eventually you make it to the top. By getting the prize, there is no next step. And this means we can choose freely where to move next. And to tell the truth, I'm also a bit scared. I don't want to leave anything behind. Specifically, nobody in the family. It's obvious that we will receive a lot of requirements and challenging professional opportunities. I just don't want to risk losing my normal, ordinary, simple family life and get lost in success. I just hope that I will have enough time to keep on being a regular father, husband, and friend to those who have always been with me since the beginning. So ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce the 2016 Pritzker Laureate, Alejandra Aravena.
This is going to be very tough. Well, I can't start this evening without a mention to Saha. When we got the news last week, we just couldn't believe it. Or maybe we didn't want to believe it. As Rafael Iglesias, an Argentinian architect that also died too early of a heart attack last year, said once, "It is always very sad when a person that still has a lot to offer dies prematurely." So from here, we send our condolences to her relatives, friends, and colleagues. Saha received the prize in 2004 for her great contribution to architecture. Her work, as well as the work of the other laureates, many of them here in this room, is celebrated by the prize as the highest level that architecture has been able to achieve. The sum of their work builds an incredible body of knowledge that I, as a student, only dreamt, and I'm not saying even to produce, only dreamt from a distant Chile just to even experience in person. At the time, we only studied architecture in Chile looking at pictures and photographs. Pritzker Prizes, for us, in the mid-80s, were not architects, were myths. That's why I didn't see this prize coming at all, not for a second. And it's as Tom said, that Saturday morning, I was trying to finish something. I never work on weekends, so my normal response would have been not to answer to the text message by Martha, "I need to talk to you about the Biennale." I would have waited until the next Monday. But since I was already, and this is the thing, working on something for the Biennale, I wanted to get rid of, so to be able to enjoy the weekend with the girls that were already playing around, I text back and said, "Okay, let's talk now." And she said, "Well, hi, Alejandro. I have three questions about the Biennale." "Okay. Would you accept to be the 2016 Pritzker Prize laureate?" The reaction is pretty much like this, for seconds and not for an entire minute. I didn't understand what that had to do with the Biennale. So I was hitting a wall, trying to understand the connection, which there was not. And so when I began to process the thing, I began to cry. There's just too much emotion. And that's the only thing I still can't say. I mean, I'm speechless because I'm thoughtless. I just can't feel the thing. I can't think about the thing. So from that moment on, I went up to wake up my wife, and I said, "Me gané el Pritzker." And for an hour, maybe, we couldn't react. We were just like this, paralyzed. And to tell the truth, I still can't today. But as days have passed, my feelings began to evolve in three different directions. When looking backwards, gratitude. When looking into the future, as Tom said, freedom. And when in the present, just pure joy and happiness. So I thought a lot about the fact that the ceremony is at the UN. What a great place to deliver a message about how architecture can correct inequalities and improve people's quality of life. For looking into the future, there will be time tomorrow here at the UN too, in a conversation with previous laureates about the challenges ahead for the built environment. So today, instead of making a public or a public policy or a message for the profession, I want to make it personal. And it's going to be about gratitude, and it's going to be about joy. First of all, I would like to thank the Pritzker family for their vision and understanding that an award may be a powerful tool to influence the development of the built environment in the right direction. You have done this not only with generosity, but mainly with quality. You have done it just right, and this is a very powerful contribution to improve people's quality of life. I would also like to thank the jury, and I want to think of the words of the citation as a brief, as a navigation chart, a path to follow more than facts about our work. We will keep your words in our minds. And this prize is for a body of work, and the work in architecture is a collective task. To start with, it's not that I wake up a morning with an incredible desire to do, let's say, an office building. Somebody has to need that building in the first place. So only then, if somebody outside of us has a need or a desire, we can start working. Architecture takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of money and energy. So we're very thankful of the clients that have trusted us great amount of resources, private and public, to translate those needs and desires into buildings. In our particular case, not only the starting point is outside ourselves, the ending point too. Many of our projects are not finished by us, by the families themselves. So we're really thankful of those families that have completed and added their resources, ideas, and dreams to the walls and roofs that we have set only as a frame. Architecture is about a lot of disciplines coming together, concurring with their knowledge and expertise to get a building built. I would not know how to do it on my own, and yet an architect has to be able to discriminate which of the approaches is better than the other. Goodwill and professional flexibility is crucial to negotiate all the forces pulling in opposite directions in a single building. But in addition, we architects do not build our projects with our own hands. We rely on the skills of many crafts, but even more on the physical strength of workers. To all of them that resist tough work on the construction side, we're very grateful as well. In our particular case at Elemental, projects and ideas, solutions and visions only appear while thinking out loud in group. It is a team creative process. This is not just a say or a politically correct statement. It's a fact. That is why I believe the partners of Elemental are as winners as I am of this prize. So I would like to ask to stand up Gonzalo Arteaga, Juan Ignacio Cerda, Victor Odo, and Diego Torres. Each of them is brilliant and could have had their own practice, but chose to stay at Elemental. Thanks for that. When we went through hard times, choosing staying was not evident at all. It meant a decision that involved each of your families. So I want to acknowledge the importance of wives and spouses to have supported our work. Andrea, Isa, Ale, and Sole. Finally, to all the people at the office that may be following this on streaming in Chile, Cristian Martinez, Su Yin Chia, Matias Magnelli, Clemens Pibaro, Euge Morales, and all the interns at the office. Thank you to you all. Some of our projects require a dedication and a level of innovation that the market and governments are not willing nor prepared to support. It was 2005 when, after a successful first project in Iquique, the Quinta Monroy, we had other 7 different projects in different stages of development throughout Chile, some under construction, some still fighting to get building permission, when we ran out of money. For a year, we had to work for free because we couldn't abandon the families halfway in the process. We had very little to show and even less proofs that we will succeed. That is why we are so thankful to the Angelini family, Roberto and Mauricio, who trusted us and had the confidence that we would use architecture to produce a public good. That is when Elemental became a company to make our contribution to people's quality of life a sustainable endeavor. Thank you. Those who had the idea to contact them were Jorge Bunster, Arturo Nato, and Alejandro Horman, the last two here in the room and in our board still today. They still contribute with brains and strategies on financial and administrative questions that I still don't understand, but that might be correct since we have never needed extra money since 2006. Before becoming a company, Elemental was an academic initiative. It all started when I was invited to teach at Harvard, and that was Jorge Silvetti's call. He may have seen something that not even myself was able to see. At the time, I did have just one building built and a book written, and I actually arrived at Harvard having no idea about what to teach, and eventually used my own ignorance and self-embarrassment as an asset. In a country where 60% of what's being built used some kind of subsidy, I had no idea what a subsidy was. It was embarrassing. When you don't know about something, there are 2 possibilities. You study, or you partner with somebody that knows. I did the latter. At a dinner party in Cambridge, I met a transport engineer that was doing his master's at the Kennedy School of Government, Andres Iacovelli. He was kind of famous because he combined 2 attributes that are rarely found together. He was brilliant, and he was a nice guy. So the conversation started with him saying, "So, seems that Chilean architecture is doing really well, isn't it?" And I say, "Well, kind of, yes. A lot of awards, huh? Yes. A lot of international recognition, huh? Yes." And I was kind of growing in pride about an engineer acknowledging an architect. I said, "But if Chilean architecture is so good, why is social housing so bad?" That hurt. But immediately afterwards, he proposed, "Why don't we do something with social housing?" In my architect's mind, do something meant a book, a seminar, an exhibition, and in my wildest dreams, a 1-to-1 full-scale prototype of a unit. In his engineer's mind, do something meant a company that should start building at least 100 units, accepting every single constraint of the existing policy, budget, size, time frame, and prove the market wrong within its own set of rules. That is how Elemental started as a do tank and not as a think tank. But I learned many more things from him, like think well about people. If somebody is successful, it's because he or she did something good, not something wrong. This is not even close to be the prevailing attitude. I don't know if it's a Chilean thing or if it's an architect's thing, but suspicion and envy are so much more common. And this is something that until today is at the very core of the spirit of Elemental. Don't waste time fighting or even paying attention to the bitter ones. Celebrate and learn from the proactive ones. Talking about learning, I had the fortune of having very good teachers and very good classmates at the Universidad Católica, where I studied architecture. I owe a lot to my professor, Fernando Pérez. He not only taught me how to think carefully and how to respect the accumulated layers of knowledge of architectural history, balancing how to be humble and self-confident at the same time in front of that knowledge. He also gave me the first opportunity. He bet on me to do my first ever project, the mathematics school at Universidad Católica. Given where I come from, I would have never had the possibility to get any kind of commission from my circle. So the only way was to have this kind of blind trust from somebody, and this was my professor. In addition to that, I had to survive university. You may not get this here in the US, but at the time I studied in Chile, only one out of four students finished the career. Nobody survives alone. That's why my classmates became lifetime friends, Claudio, Alfonso, and Charlie. We encourage each other, night after sleepless night, working in each other's project. Back then, I knew collaboration in its more pure, disinterested form. Making it to the university in the mid-80s in Chile was very hard. If you didn't go to a private high school, the chances to study at the university were extremely low. And this is where my family made a difference. My parents, Carmen and Gaston, both school teachers, worked extremely hard to allow us, my brother Cayo and my sister Loreto, to have the opportunity to study. To pay attention for education, to pay for education, did not leave a lot of money for leisure and entertainment. That is how we learned to take pleasure in very simple things. Playing on the street with whatever may explain why we created such a primitive bond with my childhood friend, Cone. Family, Sole, Teo, Noé, Simón, Elo. Thank you to you all. So after moving backwards, I would like to come back to present, which is almost entirely taken by my wife and my children. What I have achieved in architecture has allowed me to pay attention to the other dimensions of life. Instead of developing the professional dimension to unheard and seen levels, I have been trying all this time just to have a balanced life. Shu, Americo, Malu, and Rita, you are my grounding cable, dedicating a lot of time to our everyday life and ordinary activities is a great antidote to prevent too full with oneself. You have introduced the absolute present in my life, right here, right now. Niños, ustedes me enseñan cada día a distinguir lo que importa de lo que no importa. Since you were born, to distinguish what matters and what doesn't matter in life became self-explanatory. Shu, you have been generous and illuminating. If it was not for you, my life would have been poorer and less fun. You have forced me to develop. So thanks to my family, I have dedicated less time to architecture and more time to life. But to come a bit back to architecture, what we architects model is not bricks or stones or steel or wood, but life itself. Architecture is about giving form to the places where people live. It is not more complicated than that, but also not simpler than that. And life ranges from very basic needs to very deep desires, from ordinary activities to extraordinary events, from the self to the collective. So I guess that's why we should have a life in the first place. To know the subject we are trying to host, take care, and enhance is a must. Sorry for having taken so long, but I guess I was trying selfishly to make this marvelous present moment to last. Thank you very much. Gracias.
Is that your brother who just waved? I ran into a nail bear, I thought it was you. I gave him a big hello. So we have one more detail that we have to do here this evening. First, actually, Margot insists that I start. I have an envelope, and I don't know if it's a love letter from my wife, but I'm passing that along to you. And then the second is the Pritzker Prize Medal. And with this, you join quite a distinguished group of people, many of whom are here to honor you this evening. So congratulations.
Can I wear it? Good.
Yeah. You're too tall, otherwise I'd put it on you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, just before we close, I would like to read one more time the names of the Pritzker laureates here tonight, beginning with, in alphabetical order, Alejandro Aravena, Shigeru Ban, Tom Main, Richard Meyer, Glenn Murkett, Jean Nouvel, Christian de Portzamparc, Renzo Piano, Richard Rogers, and Wang Shu. Please join me in saluting all of them. This concludes the official ceremony portion of the evening. I would like to invite everyone to join us on the fourth floor in the dining room for dinner. Please, if you're able, go up the stairs and out the back. There are escalators, elevator, and stairs to arrive to the fourth floor. It's just one flight up. For those of you who do not want to take the stairs, please exit and take the elevators from the second floor, the lower level, go up two flights to the fourth floor, and please enjoy the dinner. Thank you.